everybody, and thanks for spending your International Women's Day with us here at Data and Society. It's great to have something focused on this. So I'm an ethnographer, and for the last 5 years, I've been looking at online sexism, and it's sort of, this is an expanding project that has sort of expanded to include online harassment, and now I'm also looking at the alt-right and white supremacy, because these issues are of more importance than ever given the 2016 campaign and the aftermath. And what I want to do is provide some context for the overall landscape, and I also want to talk about how the networked information technologies like Twitter, like YouTube, like Reddit, like 4chan, they do allow us to engage in collaborative participatory action, but they also make it possible for new forms of organized, gamified harassment to exist that specifically target women, people of color, queer people, and they are trying to shut down the voices of women and progressives. And so let's start out by, this is the slide I was supposed to be on. All right, so Lindy West, a pretty well-known feminist essayist, just said that feminists have been the canary in the troll mine for the last 10 years. And I think that's definitely true. So back in the mid, say like 2005, 2006, a lot of feminist bloggers I knew were being targeted by men's rights groups online, even at that time, like even like 10, 12, 13 years ago. One of them had to move cities. One of them had been stalked for 9 years by a guy who followed her from platform to platform. One very well-known feminist blog had a dedicated FBI agent to deal with the amount of death threats that they got. So these are not new behaviors, right? But some of these attacks against feminism, against feminists online and feminist groups, were previews of what we see today at a much greater scale. And in order to contextualize this, we need to go to Gamergate. Actually, it's about ethics in gaming journalism. And many of the techniques of gamified public harassment, doxing, publishing personal information online, revenge porn, which Amanda talked about, social shaming, so trying to embarrass people in front of an audience, or intimidation, were really refined during what we now know as Gamergate. Now, Gamergate is extremely complicated, but I'm gonna give you the short version. Basically, there a software developer named Zoe Quinn, his ex-boyfriend posted a 10,000-word screed on his blog about how she was like a terrible person who had lied and cheated, and most damagingly, that she had slept with a video game journalist to get coverage for her game, Depression Quest. And this was not actually true, but it turns out that this was a pretext under which a group of like 4chan trolls thought they could get more people organized in participating in her harassment. So let's say it's about ethics in video game journalism, and that'll provide an umbrella under which a lot of strange bedfellows can come together under this hashtag Gamergate. And this meant that you got this group of trolls, gamers, far-right micro-celebrities like Milo Yiannopoulos, men's rights activists, and a bunch of other just kind of like flotsam and jetsam weirdos of the internet coming together to collaborate and participate in this like very, you know, participatory culture type way to harass women involved in video games, specifically women who were critical of sexist narratives in video games. So Zoe Quinn being one of them. Obviously, probably the best known is Anita Sarkeesian of the Feminist Frequency blog, who had death threats against her and had to cancel her appearances at the University of Utah due to like some big crazy bomb threat. And this was just because they were basically saying, hey, there's some sexist stuff in video games, which I don't think would be a big surprise to any of the feminist media critics in the audience. So we can take away several really important things from Gamergate. The first is that this is an organized and gamified mob. Now, I'm not talking about the day-to-day harassment that Amanda's talking about. I'm really talking about these very high-profile edge cases, but they're no longer edge cases. They're more and more common. Anita Sarkeesian calls this cyber mobs. She describes a cooperative competition to increase harm to targets where you have subcultures that work together to reveal information on people, to dox, to get information, to create knowledge collaboratively, but they also get social status by escalating the harassment, and they score points, like not literal points, but like status in their community from being able to like upset somebody or reveal something personal about someone. And online harassment in this way really becomes a game. And the unstated goal is to maintain or reinforce social dominance over marginalized groups.
The second thing is that Gamergate shows that people who have different politics can ally together for a common cause, right? So you have people, you have like libertarians and video game fans and like paleo conservatives, and they're all sort of working together to protect ethics in video game journalism. But these sort of cyber mobs come together really quickly, and they just as quickly disseminate. So they're really, really agile in many ways. And finally, many of the ideology that Gamergaters promulgated, and as I said, this is a vast array of peoples. They don't necessarily all subscribe to it, but generally it's this idea that feminism and multiculturalism have won the culture war, and feminism is infiltrating on the rights of gamers to have free speech and to consume the types of culture that they like. And this, they also react very violently to suggestions of white male privilege, and it's really what we might call a retrograde populist ideology. This will become very salient as we approach the 2016 election, right? But I also want to talk about just the general atmosphere of sexist speech and harassment online and the more sort of everyday parts of the internet, like comment sections. So Lori Penny, a feminist essayist and journalist, wrote this great essay where she said, "An opinion, it seems, is the short skirt of the internet. Having one and flaunting it is somehow asking an amorphous mass of almost entirely male keyboard bashers to tell you how they'd like to rape, kill, and urinate on you." And I have so many gross quotes that sometimes appear in this talk, I can't even tell you, but that's not at all an exaggeration from the people I know who have received this type of abuse online. So The Guardian, the sort of left-wing British newspaper, did a study of 70 million comments on their comments section. Most of their opinion writers are white men, yet the 10 opinion writers who got the most amount of vitriolic abuse and trolling, 4 were white women, 4 were women of color, and 2 were black men, of which 1 was a gay black guy. So there's a very disproportionate amount of abuse being targeted towards women, women of color, people of color, and queer people. And what they also found was that when women stayed within like feminine realms, like fashion, they didn't get attacked. It was when they wrote about things like technology or sports that they got this kind of abuse. So there's a systematic effort here to sort of push women and progressive voices in general out of these more public topics like economics or politics or something like that. So most of the abuse that The Guardian found, the articles that got the most abuse were articles about feminism or rape. Which brings me to, so this is a tweet that I made in like 2012. I did this TV show where I talked about online misogyny, and I posted this tweet, my favorite YouTube comment on the e-patriarchy video, because they posted the video online. "I respect women, but I hate feminists. I believe that feminists should be gang raped. ! So Helen Lewis, a journalist who had also appeared on the program with me, wrote, "The comments on any article about feminism justify feminism. That is Lewis's law." And it has just been proven truer and truer in the 5 years since we had this discussion online. In fact, it's even on her Wikipedia page now. So how do we get to this point? There's a lot of different factors, but I'm just going to focus on a couple. And one of them is what we might call the manosphere. What I'm not the person who came up with that term. That's like an actual term. And it's a group of loosely affiliated blogs, fora, YouTube channels, hashtags, yada, yada, that are all about discussing masculinity. Now, generally, you know, we think men discussing masculinity is great, right? Like, yeah, let's talk about gender and how it harms everyone. No, no, that's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about people who really adhere to an ideology of male victimhood. Men's rights activists, father's rights activists, a group called Men Going Their Own Way, which is men who are so suspicious of women that they encourage other men not to get into romantic or sexual relationships with them, and let alone get married. Pickup artists in the seduction community who trade tips on how to get women into bed. General anti-feminist groups, and then people from other fringe communities, well, not fringe, but other communities like, you know, Bitcoin or atheism or libertarianism who have similar leanings. And these communities, again, they're an umbrella, right? They might disagree on some things, but they do come together around the hatred of feminists. And because these groups are in many ways homophilous, birds of a feather flock together, they push people to the extremes of their opinion, because you're not getting any dissenting voices. So the sort of extreme anti-feminist view is just getting amplified. And there's a huge overlap between this group and what we now think of as the alt-right. So one of the things that I've been really interested in is the way that these groups use vocabulary to disseminate their ideas. And one of their words is misandry, which is basically their word for what feminism is, which is hatred of men. So it's the male version of misogyny. And they're really, really successful at furthering these terms that describe a world where the deck is stacked against men and feminized behavior is like rewarded. Like feminists control everything, according to these dudes. Like it sounds like an amazing world to live in that they believe in. Another one of their terms is white knights, which are men who believe in feminist ideologies because they think the only reason a man would espouse a feminist ideology is to try to get a woman to like them, right? Or to like save a damsel in distress. They were the ones who came up with the social justice warrior pejorative for any type of like progressive activist. And most recently, they're also the ones who came up with the idea of the cuck, which you may have heard during the 2016 election. Now, cuck is basically means like a beta male, a guy who's emasculated, a guy who's not like the big man on campus. But it comes from cuckold, and specifically it comes from a porn genre called cuckolding, which shows white guys, white wives having sex with black men. So there's an intrinsic white supremacist patriarchal ideology built into this term, and the more it's furthered, the more that ideology is able to spread. So not only do we have an increase in sexist slurs, we have an increase in these weird rhetorical moves to discuss feminism using intrinsically anti-feminist terms. And you'll see this throughout the internet in like a whole bunch of spaces. Like these words go all over the place from the manosphere on out. So I want to turn to another reason, which I think is behind some of this, which is troll culture. And on sites like 4chan and 8chan in the last few years, you've really seen a move towards using very explicitly racist, homophobic, and sexist language. Now, there's a couple of reasons for this. First is because people get upset when you use like the N-word or the F-word against them, and trolls like to rile people up and cause emotion in them. Another reason is that those things aren't acceptable, and it's seen by a lot of these denizens of these groups to be like edgy and rebellious by throwing around like racist terms. However, when such language becomes common, it becomes normalized, and it facilitates radicalization. If you're hanging out in spaces where sexist language is totally acceptable, even if you think you're being like joking and ironic, you're still more liable to be open to the ideas of the men's rights movement. And similarly, if you're hanging out in a place where everybody espouses like disgusting racist beliefs to be like edgy or whatever, that's another huge gateway to the popularization of white supremacist views, which is where I think the alt-right comes in and where you see this appeal to this sort of wider population of white supremacy and white nationalism. So a couple of implications from this cheerful talk. The first is that even though we know, and for years we know, that social media enables participation and creativity, that doesn't mean it's always used by people we agree with. We can't assume that the techniques of participatory culture are being used for progressive causes. And in fact, we have to assume that any social technology we create or use will be gamed. We have to start thinking about a threat model of social technologies. And if we're building social technologies without taking that into account, we're not being realistic about the world we live in today. Secondly, the chilling effects of these things, as you've seen from Amanda's work, are very, very real. The goal is to silence progressive voices. It's not surprising that people pull back from public speaking. Like, these are scary things to experience. But it means that there's a reinforcement effect here, where less women are in these spaces talking about these topics, and so the ones who still exist are rarer still, and then they're subject to more of the harassment. So the same techniques that were refined during Gamergate and perfected during the 2016 election are now being used against progressives, journalists, activists, all over the world by a huge variety of actors. So this will only become more common, not less. So now I want to talk about solutions, which luckily Zara is going to be following up with. This is a really hard problem. Like, it's like saying, how do we solve sexism? Like, we've been trying for a while. We haven't figured that one out. I think that there's a combination of technological solutions, policy solutions, normative solutions. But I do want to say to anyone who has been harassed or is dealing with, there is support for you. There are organizations set up specifically for social support for people who've experienced harassment. And if you see sexist or racist language online, please speak up. Please say something about it. Even if we can't eliminate online harassment and sexism, we want to make it less common, less acceptable, and not part of the everyday. Thank you.
And so we wanted to be sure that we were measuring that as well as the actual exposure of the images. And so it's about 2% of people who say somebody has posted an explicit image, which isn't actually that many people if you really think about it. I'm sorry, it's not a big percentage, but it is actually quite a large number of people broadly in the country if you back it out to sort of the millions of people potentially affected. And as you can see from the second bullet, it is something that is much more common amongst young women. Young women are by far most likely to be victimized in this way. And also, LGB individuals are also much more likely to experience non-consensual image sharing. 17% have experienced the threats, and 7% have experienced the sharing of those images. And I will say that, you know, as I said today, we're really focusing on women in this talk, but LGB individuals are by far more likely to experience almost every single one of these harassment experiences than heterosexual individuals. And that's, I think, for a broader and longer conversation, but that's another really main and important finding of the study. It's one that we're just only touching on really peripherally today. And so I think other things that are important are things around impact, right? So we see that there's this, that these things happen to women. So what's the effect? And it turns out that women and men who have both experienced these forms of harassment are more likely to say that they are angry, worried, and scared by these experiences that they've had. And men are a bit more likely to say that they are not bothered by them. Now, the not bothered data is a little bit complicated because you can actually say yes to all of these questions, and we did have people who said yes to the not bothered, and then also to I'm also angry and I'm also annoyed. So take it for what it's worth, but we do see that in this data, really women are having more negative emotional reactions to the experiences of being harassed. And I think what's really the crux of the matter for us and was a real challenge in this research is that it turns out that different groups of people, namely men and women, have very different perceptions about what constitutes harassment. Like, when you asked men and women to say, those who had said yes to the same set of questions, at least one of the same set of questions, women were just simply more likely, 53% of women versus 41% of men, to say, yes, what I experienced was harassment. And we included that question because when we tested our study, we found that a large, substantial swath of people were like, what are you talking about? Like, I wasn't harassed. This was just a thing. It wasn't a big deal. And some of this, again, is that, trying to drill down as to why that is. Again, differential experiences, the types of harassment women experience are different than what men experience, and maybe thus having these sort of more severe consequences and a greater perception of the experience as being harassment. But also the stigma that we apply to men who are harassed, right? It may not necessarily be as easy to say, I have been harassed, to define yourself as somebody who is a victim of harassment if you are male, in addition to sort of the differential perceptions. And so I think it's important for our broader questions, and as we kind of talk a little bit later, to unpack some of these differentials around who actually thinks this stuff is harassment and who doesn't. It's also important, and I bring this up, to understand who sees this, right? So this harassment exists in the ambient social digital space that we live in, right? We see it. It's out there. 72% of internet users have witnessed at least one harassing behavior towards somebody else. And again, this is a sort of a basic laundry list of some of those behaviors. It turns out young adults, African-American, LGB internet users are much more likely to say that they've witnessed harassment than other groups. And the reason why this is important is because whether or not you've witnessed harassment plays into this idea of whether or not you censor yourself. And so we asked a final question on our survey, which is, have you ever decided not to post something online because you were afraid you would be harassed because of it? And we found that it turns out young women are by far most likely to say that they've experienced that. It's 41% of young women compared to just 33% of young men. And it also turns out that LGB internet users, young people, are also more likely to say that they have self-censored themselves because of fears of harassment. And so if you've witnessed other people being harassed, if you yourself have been harassed, all of those things play into a greater likelihood of you saying yes To this question, that you have self-censored yourself, you have decided not to post something online. And again, I think later we should talk about what that means when we have a subset of people, particularly young women, but other groups of people as well, who decide not to add their voices into our communal digital space, right? Who are we missing? We're missing people. What does that mean for us broadly, as a democracy, as a society? And so I also want to talk a little bit, we're coming to the end, I want to talk a little bit about what kinds of strategies victims use to protect themselves. So the rest of this data is almost entirely, actually this slide is about people who specifically say, yes, I experienced this and I define myself as a victim. And people, you know, change contact information. They ask for help from various family members or various institutions, whether that's a legal institution, whether that's a domestic violence assistance group. They flag content about themselves in an attempt to remove it from the systems. But they also disconnect from online networks. They stop using cell phones, not that many of them, but they disconnect from networks. They stop using social media in particular, and in some cases stop going online. And I think it's important to acknowledge that victims take steps to protect themselves, that they empower themselves by doing many of these, by engaging these activities. But we should remember that many of these activities also remove you from the support of your networks, right? When you go off to social media, you're missing the possibility of being supported through the experience of being harassed by other people who could again provide you support through that medium. Similarly, again, disconnecting from your networks is a pretty harsh penalty for the experience of online harassment. And finally, to leave on a slightly more positive note, that there are, in fact, bystanders. People who witness this do actually take action. Whether it's effective, we're not really sure, but they do. About 45% say they said something to the person who was targeted, supporting the target. Other people, 40% jump in and say something to the aggressor. And about 38% flag the behavior in the platforms. Now, it's not clear that all this always happens in platforms where flags are possible. But again, people do take action. About 65%, I believe, of people who witnessed harassment did take some kind of action after the fact. So I'm going to stop there, and hopefully we've started us off for a good conversation. I guess Alice is going to take it.
Right. Wow, that was quite a depressing talk to have to follow. But I like that there's puppies on the screen for me now. So I'm just gonna talk a little, like, very quickly about a couple of solutions or kind of creative responses to the issues that Amanda and Alice both discussed. And then we'll have a little conversation, and then there'll be space for questions and more discussions with you guys. So this is what they called a digital solidarity quilt. Which is an initiative from a group called the Association for Progressive Communications, who I've done some work with. They're fantastic. They're mostly based in the Global South. They have offices in Cape Town and Kuala Lumpur and, lots of different countries. But they set this up as part of their campaign that's called Take Back the Tech, that encourages women and people who have been marginalized online to take back the tech, to try and take back control, to kind of flip that narrative of being victims and suffering abuse, and instead kind of think about what you can do to take it back and to make that technology into something that you want to have again. So on this site, anyone can upload a square that is a kind of an image that means something to you, or with a message, and there's some kind of pre-programmed messages that you can add to it. And then when you hover over it, it kind of flips over and tells you who this section of the quilt was from. And I really like this because, you know, it brings quilting and the kind of crafting to the digital space, and you can just kind of see this message of solidarity and kind of a refusal to let the voices and struggles of people who have been abused and who might be otherwise inclined to kind of step down or remove or leave the platforms, as Amanda was talking about, and put them back online together. So this same group has been with a fantastic community holding meetings over the last 3 or 4 years to come up with the feminist principles of the internet. So instead of saying we don't want this, we don't know we definitely don't want what we've got so far, trying to come up with principles of what we do want and what we are working for. And they cover all sorts of topics across the left. You can see there, from kind of access, information, memory, anonymity, violence. I really like these as a way of thinking in a more kind of what are we actually aiming for? That makes a lot of sense to me. I think it is difficult to go from these principles that are very abstract and sound really great when you're in a room of, you know, 80 feminists being like, yeah, this is what we're aiming for, to actually what would it take to get there. So that's been an interesting, like, you know, we've had these meetings over the last, over the last few years, and mostly it was coming up with what principles do we need that make sense to everyone, because it's always been a very global meeting, and I think lots of the things we talked about are very, very cultural specific, which make them difficult to agree upon or even to see or understand issues in the same way. So this has been a great step towards kind of understanding or coming up with some solution that we can all agree with. So yeah, I'd recommend you check those out if you're interested. And then this is a campaign from a group called PENG in Berlin, the PENG Collective, who are fantastic and do all sorts of creative activism things. They've done some other great things as well. So this was called Zero Tolerance, labeled as self-help for trolls in 6 simple steps. So they actually created these videos, these kind of self-help videos going from denial, internet, anger, fear, hate, and troll. So what you could do was you could sign up someone to, like, so if you have a troll online, you could say, you could tweet at ZTolerance, and it would sign them up to this program using a bot. So they had this army of bots that would tweet a link and tweet one of these videos at that troll, a different one every day, so you couldn't block the particular bot, the particular handle, and it would tweet one of these every day for 6 days, and you would be enrolled on the 6-step self-help program, and it was just really, it's a fantastic campaign, because it's kind of funny, it's feminist, it's like, it's taking that narrative of what it means to be a troll and really making it into a, you know, it's going through maybe what might be the kind of crux of why trolls are doing this. I mean, like, I highlighted the zero fear one, to challenge your perceptions of gender and privilege and face your fears. I think that might actually speak very closely to why trolls are doing this. So that was a really good one that I liked a lot. And then the final one I wanted to share, the second to last one, is from a group in Brazil called Coding Rights. And they released this kind of zine, I guess, called A Sexy Guide to Digital Security. So instead of lots of the guides that we see nowadays and lots of the way that we talk about using the internet is careful not to do this. Don't make sure you don't, you know, don't take nude pictures of yourself if you don't want anyone to see them. But this tells you how to send nude pictures in a safe way. So it takes back the narrative of, it kind of empowers you a little bit more with the message of, you know, you can do whatever you want. It's your body, it's your technology, and you're going to, you know, do what you want, and this is how you can do it in a safe way. So I really like this one as kind of flipping that narrative as well. And then the final one is this cyber harassment helpline that was set up just recently, I think in December, by the Digital Rights Pakistan group. So it's an actual helpline that you can call, and you get through to a person who can talk you through what options you have, and just be someone that you can share your experiences with if you are being harassed online in a very kind of sensitive way, because I think they noticed that when you report lots of these things to police, especially in countries where, and I think we'll talk about this a little bit later, but when the state is the harasser, you're not going to be most likely to report that to the state, because that's very counterintuitive and doesn't really make sense. Whereas this is a, you know, an independent nonprofit organization that provides you with at least some support and some advice, if not actually being able to respond in with a regulatory or legal solution. I guess that's all I wanted to share. But maybe we can just have a little bit of a conversation now. I think we have to move our. We have to move our. Oh. Cool. Great. Well, thank you both for your talks. That was fascinating. You both mentioned kind of bystanders and allies, and you, Amanda, you were saying that lots of bystanders actually do take action. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about how useful those kinds of actions actually were, or because, I mean, you both said, you know, if you see something happening online, like, please do say something, but has that actually been proven, or have you seen any examples where that's very, very successful?
I haven't. So our work didn't go that next step and ask about what the impact was of that intervention. So, and that question was also asked of the witness. So they may not actually know, in some cases, what the impact was. They may know, I reported that, I reported it 4 times, but they may not know actually what the ultimate endpoint was. So we don't know, and at least in the data that I collected.
Well, I don't know if you guys noticed, but my talk had no data. Just kidding. But it's this is a big ongoing project, and right now I'm interviewing people who've experienced online harassment, and it's too nebulous to know exactly what my findings from that are going to be. But I strongly believe in the power of norm setting, that there are online spaces where, like, you just don't see any sexist commentary, right? Like, it's just not acceptable there, and there's spaces where it is acceptable. Like, I spend a lot of time on Reddit, and some of the subreddits that I'm in, like, there's no sexist comments at all, and some of the subreddits I'm in, there's, like, a bunch of them, right? And it's about what is the culture in that particular community, and what do people think is acceptable? So I'm not sure how much, that's not, like, a short-term solution, right? Like, that might not help the person in the minute that they're getting harassed, but I do think it can help to create particular cultures online of, like, the type of civility we want to see.
And I will also say that there are resources, that it's not just about witnesses and bystanders. There are other resources. You highlighted some of them. There's some, you know, my work was in the US context, and at the end of our harassment reports, we provided links to places like the National Network to End Domestic Violence and HeartMob, Without My Consent, Speak Up, Stay Safe, the Stalking Resource Center. There's a number of places out there and hotlines that can at least begin the process of helping people to kind of navigate some of these experiences. So even if you don't necessarily have bystanders standing up for you, there are other people who can help you intervene in other ways.
Yeah. And Amanda, you talked a little bit about, and I thought it was really interesting how you mentioned kind of perceptions of harassment. So women are more likely to perceive that they are being harassed, whereas men are less likely. I wonder if, I mean, both from experience or from your research, how the abuser, the person carrying out that harassment, whether they actually perceive it as harassment or not. There was a case, I think last year or the year before, the first person who was charged with a criminal case in the UK of actually being a troll and doing, kind of committing or engaging in online harassment, and this really great BuzzFeed profile with her, this interview with her, went into, I have to say, these quotes from her where she said she didn't think it was real because it was online, and she was just frustrated, and she was a teenager, and she had all these problems, and she didn't think anyone would ever take her seriously. And I wondered if you had any experiences with how abusers or people doing this harassment actually see it.
You know, so again, our research didn't just focus strictly on the victim side, so we don't have that in the data. I mean, I do think that's it's a good question. It's a complicated question. I think also in our research, we were looking at a really wide variety of behaviors, and I am, you know, 100% sure that there are some people who were engaging in many of those behaviors. And again, this is why we had that question on our survey, which is, do you believe what you experienced was harassment? So not even only what the actual aggressor believed, but what the victims themselves believed. So I think there's a lot of different perceptions in different communities and different subgroups about what actually constitutes harassment and harassing behavior. And so I think there's a place there for expanding that conversation. I mean, it also, I think, comes back to we were talking about this earlier today, a little bit about your subject position in the space, right? If you're a powerful person, what you perceive as what you yourself understand to be abusive behavior and what you, in fact, experience as abusive behavior from somebody else can be quite different than somebody who has substantially less kind of social power than you do. And so, you know, in our culture, that's often still white men who tend to occupy the spaces which of sort of the greatest power, or we can say wealthy people. I mean, there's a bunch of different demographics we could point to. But your level of fear and concern and the way you perceive a lot of different experiences that are harassing to others can be quite different. And I think there's questions about what that means broadly about creating technologies and who's creating the technologies and what kinds of things are embedded and assumptions are embedded within the technologies that we use when you have a place and a space that is heavily dominated by a group of people who are broadly quite socially powerful.
I think this is a difficult question because we're talking about a constellation of behaviors. And so it's not like there's a type of person who's like a harasser who walks around with horns, right? There's just people who engage in harassing behavior. And both Amanda and I used to do research on bullying. And one of the things that we found when we were doing research on bullying, oh, so many years ago, is that a lot of the time, somebody who's a bully in one context can be bullied in another context and vice versa, because bullying, again, is a similar, like, it's an umbrella term used to describe a bunch of different kinds of behaviors. What I found from my research, obviously the type of harassment I was describing was ideologically motivated. So that's really motivated by ideology. That's not at all the case for all types of harassment. Like, I'm specifically talking about gendered online harassment and networked misogyny. I think that when you're talking about trolls, a lot of the time they're motivated by a bunch of different factors. Like, they think it's funny, they want to try to get people riled up, and there's a bunch of people have done good research on that, like Whitney Phillips has a great book on that. And then other people, I think, do feel that it's justified because they're harassing somebody for some perceived slight or something they said that they didn't like or they didn't agree with them. Like, with a lot of the anti-feminist trolling, one of the things that I found is that there's a really strong belief that feminists are trying to threaten freedom of speech. And so people really do think they're justified in attacking feminists because they believe that freedom of speech is like a fundamental aspect of the United States that has to be protected at all costs. And in that case, you're gonna see a totally different motivation from somebody who like broke up with their boyfriend and is like using social media to harass him because they're upset and jealous and angry. So again, because online harassment is a very big umbrella term, it's really hard to discern universal motivations.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And I think the thing you said about kind of bullying begets bullying is very interesting. And Dana actually wrote a piece a couple of days ago, I don't know if you both saw it, on mentioning how kind of the people who had been bullying towards her themselves felt very oppressed. Mm-hmm. And I think that's something that we saw in both of your talks. And I guess I wonder how to, like, given the situation that the United States is in right now and lots of areas in the world of being very split across the ideological spectrum, how we are meant to kind of bring those together without having to engage, or whether we might have to engage with all these really awful communities that you know, as you were saying, like these anti-feminist spaces, these men's rights activists, how are they ever gonna change those opinions apart from get more, like further along the spectrum away from kind of understanding the feminist point of view without being exposed to it, if you get me?
Yeah, I don't know. I wish I knew.
I'm glad you said that, Alice, because I'm thinking, what am I going to say?
I don't know. I mean, I wish I knew that. I would, like, it's like, I would want world peace. I don't know. I think that some of this stuff, like, we're in a weird cultural moment right now because a lot of people feel empowered to say and do things that they wouldn't have felt were socially acceptable before, because the 2016 campaign opened room for a lot of weird sexist and racialized rhetoric that I think a lot of us naively thought, like, oh, that's not going to be in public discourse. We're not going to be debating, like, are Jews people? Like, we've resolved that question. Guess not. CNN had an alt-right speaker on, and the Chiron underneath him was like, alt-right says, are Jews people? ? I was like, CNN, that is not appropriate. That sense of like opening the Overton window to allow for a bunch of viewpoints in that weren't previously or had previously been deemed unacceptable, I think is what I feel really overwhelmed by what I see is like this new type of rhetoric. It's really shocking and scary. And of course, I probably feel that way because I'm like a white woman who hasn't had to deal with like violent racism being like thrown at me my whole life. But in terms of how we deal with this, I don't know. I don't know if this is like a permanent change to the cultural landscape or whether this is something that will blow over. I do think that a lot of the political movements I'm seeing online are really motivated by Black Lives Matter as a reaction against Black Lives Matter, as against the anti-police brutality movement, against Ferguson, all those types of things. And they're really motivated against popular feminism because feminism is probably more popular now than it has been since like the 1970s. And I think both of those things have really created like a very strong reaction from a lot of people who feel threatened.
Just to pick up on what you mentioned about kind of the race aspect. I know we talked a lot about gender today because it's International Women's Day, but Yeah, I guess I wondered how kind of aspects of racism or other types of discrimination are kind of interlinked with the issues that you've experienced or that you've been working on or seen with your research.
Sure. So, you know, the racial and ethnic data is challenging in the research. We don't see as much of that as an issue as we do for young people, LGB, and women. There are places around witnessing where we see it. I also think that some of that is an artifact of how the data was collected, that because we were focusing in on people who self-defined as harassed, we ended up with a very small population of people. And so I don't think we saw things in the data that weren't statistically significant that suggest to me that with a larger sample size, they would be statistically significant. And so I think some of what I presented is probably missing or suppressing some of that as an issue, but it's not currently in the data as we have it.
I think all evidence shows that intersectionality is really important in understanding harassment, because the people who get like the worst of it are definitely women of color, especially queer women of color. I mean, it's like everything you can think of will be like a lot of these movements, they're looking for like what they see as vulnerability, and they're drawing from like really like traditionally racist, sexist, anti-Semitic discourse, right? Like they're not coming up with like new brilliant ways to call somebody like a gross bitch. They're really drawing from very sort of classic tropes of white supremacy, white nationalism, anti-Semitism. So the more of those boxes you tick, the more you're going to suffer it, but also the more you're going to be seeing as a threat to, you know, white nationalism or white supremacy. So in the research that I'm doing, I'm trying to not see this solely through the lens of gender. Like it's hard because obviously like that. It's how I started this project, was looking at sort of online sexism. But I think that if you convened a panel on online harassment that was just like black men, they would have experienced harassment in a totally different way than the dynamics that I'm seeing. And that I think is a really interesting open research question that I don't know the answer to.
Cool. All right. Yeah. Do we want to open it up to the floor if there are any questions from you all?
And I think we'd also really love to hear if people have strategies that they've used in response to harassment or ideas. I mean, we wanted to make this, to leave this on a more positive note than potentially our presentations have done. And so we're very interested in having it be a conversation about experiences and about strategies, as well as just about other questions.
I'll take this one.
Yeah.
Who has a question?
Yeah, just wondering about if you have any information on the sort of online versus offline, how the numbers would compare, or you know, the distinguishing between these things.
So our data didn't look at offline except for that one question around being victimized in person after you'd been victimized offline. And it's difficult to compare the numbers. Most of the data collections around cyberstalking and harassment are not that recent that I was aware of. And so I think the digital world has changed that experience, right? It's opened up new opportunities for modes of abuse for abusers and people who wish to harass and harm others. And so I'm reluctant actually to go back and make a relationship between the data that's even 7 or 8 years old, because I think the situation is just super different. You know, certainly in the cyberbullying realm, which again, Alice and I have a fair amount of experience with, and that's, you know, focused on sort of somewhat similar behaviors amongst minors, at least in the way that I did it, we saw that in those populations, it's still in person. Like, it happens there. It also happens online, but in person is the first place it happens and sort of still the larger place, and that online is a close second. So I don't know how well that maps to adult behaviors, but if I had to hazard a guess, I would say it's similar.
Yeah, I guess just to add to that, I think one of the most surprising to me examples that I had recently of kind of the online-offline mix was I can't remember what country it was exactly, somewhere in sub-Saharan Africa, where girls were scared. Well, one of the forms of abuse that they were experiencing was when girls were coming out of school, boys would kind of gather around them, put their arm around them, and get their friend to take a photo, and then they would blackmail the girl because their parents would be very angry if they'd been that close physically to a boy. So that's kind of a really interesting, well, it's not what in, for example, in this country for many people would be considered to be abuse or anything that could be worth kind of doing in that sense. But yeah, that was the kind of level of abuse that they were, well, yeah, the levels of threats that they were facing in that situation.
Hi, back here. I was told to introduce myself, but everybody at the front knows who I am. So I'm Robin. I'm a researcher here at Data and Society. My question is around some of the freedom of speech implications of the research that you're doing. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about the impact of people who are being harassed, getting kicked off of online spaces, and who you think should be held responsible for creating spaces that allow discourse from everyone, whether that's platform owners, governments, other online actors, et cetera.
You're going to put us on the spot, aren't you, Robin?
I love that question. I know you can answer
that.
It, so.
You know, I think it for me was the major takeaway of this research, which is that voices are being suppressed in the name of free speech in many cases. The thing that was quite interesting to me that I hadn't really thought about, but that I thought about quite a bit after I completed this work, is that a lot of our digital discourse happens in spaces that are private. They are owned by corporations, and so free speech laws do not apply. Corporations are free to apply whatever types of regulations they would like into the spaces that they create. And so most of them still hew to the free speech rules that we have set up, but it's really only the government and our speech in relation to the government where free speech really applies. And so I think there is room there for some of our creators of our digital spaces where we have a lot of this discourse to change behavior. However, I am not, you know, I am not a technological determinist. I don't think that that is the only place where we can do this. I think there's clearly need for sort of changing our social narratives. I demurred on that question about how to fix the polarization in this country because it's a really, really hard question. I don't have a roadmap like, oh, if we just do these 7 things with kids starting at age 7, everything's going to be great. You know, I don't think that's how this works. I think we have really interesting, I mean, in my own world, I think a lot about how parents interact with kids and the kinds of rights that children have in relation to their parents, in relation to how they spend their time in the internet. And the United States has a very specific and very parent-focused idea about who gets to decide what kids see and do. And we have a lot of different ideologies of parents in this country, and that gets transmitted to children in different ways and results in the kinds of things that we see. So I think there's room. There's also, I think, legal room to sort of crack down more on some of the speech that is truly hate speech. And I think we still don't have a great handle on sort of jurisdictions and how that applies to these digital spaces. But I think that's another space for potential interventions. But
yeah, I mean, I think one of the important things to understand is that most of the social media that we use to communicate, it's not just private. It's built by U.S. tech companies and tech. People who design social technologies often adhere to like a very particular strain of like techno-utopian libertarianism, and that really does hold free speech as like a central value. So when you have a site like Reddit or Twitter, one of the things that they're set up to do is to facilitate free discourse, and that worked great for a while, right? But again, it doesn't work unless you assume that everybody is a good actor, that people really do want to go on and share their opinions, and their goal is not to just be a bunch of Twitter eggs like hurling anti-Semitic abuse at some like poor writer whose last name is Goldberg or whatever. There's a professor at Northeastern, Joe Regal, who does work on Wikipedia, and one of the things that he's found is that when you have spaces that don't really have regulate, like everyone gets to talk, right? And you don't ever kick anyone out of the community and everybody has a voice. What that ends up meaning is you have like one or two like kind of crazy blowhard people, especially ones who are dudes who talk over women, then all the women leave, right? So you're really just privileging those people with the super loud voices and you're drowning out the voices of all the other people, which is exactly what Amanda was saying. But this has been a really difficult thing, I think, for tech companies to come to terms with. I think that's one of the reasons we've seen Twitter be so super slow at regulating speech in the space, because they really believe in the value of free speech. But in order to allow diverse voices, we have to start understanding what mechanisms are preventing people from speaking. And it's not always government censorship, right? It's often a lot of other mechanisms. Like power relationships and inequalities exist on the internet, just like they do in regular life.
No, I mean, I think the only thing I would say on the free speech thing is, as someone who's only moved to the US in September, I've literally never heard two words said more in my entire life. Like, like, you guys talk about free speech all the time, even when it's really obvious that, you know, something, if it's dehumanizing, should not be allowed. There'll always be someone being like, but free speech. Like, what? Like, clearly this means something to you that I do not get, because there's this, you know, much clearer line for, I think, many people in many other countries, where if it's dehumanizing or deeply offensive or, you know, any of these things, it would not be allowed. And I think that's kind of speaks to the fact, like, as Alice was saying, that many of these systems and technologies have been built in the US, and, you know, clearly your kind of cultural values have been embedded into that, and there's a whole conversation we didn't really have around kind of who is designing those systems, whose values are being involved, who's being excluded from the design, and who should be included to make those systems more welcoming and inclusive for other people who aren't in that room.
Hi, I'm Michelle Tepper. One of the things that I found myself thinking about is the way we talk about young Muslim men getting radicalized online. And within the manosphere, you clearly see young white men, white Christian men, getting radicalized online, and we don't talk about it that way. And so I don't have a question, just maybe a comment, that perhaps starting to try and frame the conversation in terms of radicalization and using some of that same language might also be a way that we can start to shift the conversation.
Yeah, I think that's entirely accurate. I think radicalization is a really good frame through which we can understand these, because these beliefs aren't mainstream, right? They're not run-of-the-mill, and they're coming from a place of anger and frustration in similar ways that other types of radicalization are coming from. And I think that in order to combat this, it's not just a matter of, like, shutting down a subreddit we don't like, or, you know, banning some particular words from, like, Twitter hashtags. It's going to have to address some of the root causes, which is always a difficult solution.
I'd like to hear you talk a little bit about how you think having our president, who is like fed by trolls essentially for his news and analysis, how do you think that changes sort of the discourse and the behavior of folks online?
So I just want to, that was loud. Just want to preface this by saying that I'm, you know, I don't take a position politically for professional reasons, but saying that, I think, you know, the campaign and the kinds of discourse that we had in the campaign and the type of rhetoric that we hear coming in our sort of political sphere now, I think is changing things. I think I don't have quantitative data yet to tell you, like, how it's changing things. But I certainly see that, you know, I released a report in my new job about sort of youth's understanding of and how they feel about sort of political figures in the country, and they're not really positive about anybody. And I think, I don't necessarily think this is particularly helpful, and I think it's modeling behavior for young people that's really not helpful. But I don't know that I can directly make that relationship between that political discourse and trolling, but maybe other people at the table want to.
So this is a big question. I think that, so during, we've been spending a lot of time looking at the stuff going online in the months running up to the 2016 election. And there's definitely this like internet subculture of people hanging out on 4chan and 8chan who are creating memes, who are specifically supporting Donald Trump. There's a huge subreddit called The Donald that is like really, really active and kept getting like to the front page of Reddit. And their support of Trump is weird, because some of them are just like, Trump is a weird, funny guy. Like, he's just fun to make fun of. Like, let's meme him into the White House. And some of them are like legit alt-right people who agree with Trump's anti-immigrant, like anti-woman's like points of view, really want to build a wall. Like, they really believe that. And a lot of that stuff lines up with some of the more like paleoconservative, like a historical America first positions that we see the alt-right draw from in their, like, what they have of, like, an ideological discourse. I think that it's really complicated by the fact that the relationship between mainstream media and social media is really intertwined and weird, right? Like, journalism is incentivized in many ways to, like, look through, like, comb through social media to find potential news stories. And when you're talking about subcultures that are really, really, really internet savvy and really understand how to game social media to get their content into the mainstream media, then you have pathways by which things that were just kind of hanging out in these weird subcultural spaces get propelled into the mainstream. Like, you have Trump, who is retweeting images that appeared on 8chan, it's crazy. And then the people on 8chan are like, oh my God, like, we're so powerful. We have magic powers. You can sort of understand where they're coming from when that kind of thing is happening. So I think this election really shows how different our media environment is and how from even what it was when during the Obama campaign, and how a lot of political strategies and activist strategies are going to have to radically change in order to come to terms with this new information landscape.
Oh, hi, sorry. I just wanted to sort of respond to asking about interventions that we're working on. I'm Mitu Kandeka. I'm a professor at NYU of, you know, teaching games, and I'm also a chief creative officer at a company called Spirit. We're basically building various kinds of, like, AI-driven tools to help basically middleware and tools to sort of help specifically make games and other things better in lots of ways. So one of those things is this solution we're working on called Ally, which I was sort of like heading up designing, which is all about not only using AI to sort of intervene in situations of harassment, but, you know, and detect them as well. So there's, like, you know, big data analysis, predictive analysis. But the key thing to sort of, I guess, almost sidestep the sort of free speech issue is, like, putting the victim in the center, right? And letting them define sort of what, like, safe and comfortable means to them. Because, you know, we all have really different boundaries in different contexts, right? Like, what's okay for one person to say to us in a particular context is not okay in another. So it's really about giving sort of partners in games, and we're sort of working initially with some people in games already, sort of tools to let people say, oh, I'm not okay with this type of thing in this context, but it is okay when it's like a friend, etc. So that's just like one piece, sort of, you know, and again, that's solving the sort of technology piece of it, right? There's obviously a lot of other things that need to happen as well, but yeah, hopefully that's like one small part.
Thank you.